Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna alhamdulillahi ta'ala nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. Man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lah wa man yudlil fala hadiya lah. Wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah wahdahu la sharika lah. Wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan 'abduhu wa rasuluhu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. As we mentioned last week, that from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also min ihsan al-sharia, from the goodness of the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the ahkam, the rules and regulation from that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has obligated upon us, mabniya ala al-yusr wa takhfif wa rahmah, that all of these things, they're built upon mercy, ease, and also they're built on mercy, ease, and not overburdening. So the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that which you're obligated with, is based upon ease. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the greatest of his obligation to us is what? To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I've not created jinn and mankind except to worship me. And from the greatest act of ibadah, in fact, the greatest pillar of al-Islam after the shahad of La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah is what? As-salah. And even this salah which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has obligated upon us, the ruling of it is built upon what? The principle of La yukallifullahu nafsan illa wus'aha. Allah doesn't burden a soul with more than it can bear. So even when it comes to salah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us with, whatever we cannot do in the salah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not burden us with it. So last week we looked at Bab Salat al-Marid, the chapter of the prayer of the ill. This week we're going to look another example of the takhfif in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ease in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this week we're going to be going through Bab Salat al-Musafir, the chapter on the prayer of the musafir, the traveler. And this particular chapter is one of the most important chapters of fiqh. Because this particular chapter is one that confuses many people due to the so much ikhtilaf, differences of opinion concerning ahkamul musafir, the one who is traveling. And these rulings we're going to go through today bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Rulings such as, what constitutes a travel? When do you become a traveler? Is it based on the time it takes you to reach a destination? Is it based on distance, or is there no regulation at all and it all just goes back to customs and practices? Also, we're going to look at ahkam musafir in terms of if a person travels, after how many days does he have? After how many days does he have to start praying the prayer normally? Meaning he could not shorten his prayer. We're also going to look at ahkam al-qasr, the ruling of qasr, shortening prayers. Is it obligatory? Is it sunnah? Is it one of the two? So these ahkam, the rules and regulation concerning the musafir, they're extremely important. And as we mentioned, this is from an example of takhfif, ease in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when you're a traveler, the ahkam of a traveler, we see the ease in it, that you have what's called a rukhsa, permission or permits. Permits to shorten your prayer. Permits to wipe over your sock for 3 days. Permits for else that in the day hours of Ramadan, you're allowed to break your fast in Ramadan. And these permits from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about them, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَن تُؤْتَ رُخَصَهُ كَمَا يَكْرَهُ أَن تُؤْتَ مَعْصِيَتُ. Allah ta'ala loves for you to take advantages of these permission and the permits which is giving you, the same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He hates for you to disobey Him. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّهَا صَدَقَةً, that these permissions and these permits that's been given to the traveler, إِنَّهَا صَدَقَةً, it's a صَدَقَةً, تَصَدَّقَ اللَّهُ بِهَا عَلَيْكُمْ, a صَدَقَةً from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make things easier for the traveler, تَخْفِيف. So the hikmah, the wisdom behind these rules and regulations is what? To lift the mashaqqah, the hardship. And notice I said here, the wisdom and not the reason. It's very important to differentiate between hikmah wal-illah, between wisdom and reason. Jayid? For example, why do we fast in Ramadan? And what is the hikmah of fasting in Ramadan? The hikmah of fasting in Ramadan are many. Health reasons. Another hikmah, you get a feeling of how those who are less fortunate than yourself feel, that are starving. So it makes you more charitable. All this is what? Hikmah. But what is the illah of fasting? And the illah is very important to know. Because the ahkam, the rules and regulation, like we mentioned last week, they're based on what? The illah, the reason. And we mentioned the qa'idah, very important. Al-illah taduru ma'a hukmihi adaman wa wujudan. So long as the illah, the reason is there, the ruling is there. So what is the illah of Ramadan? The illah of Ramadan, na'am? Barakallahu feek. The reason we fast in Ramadan is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, la'allakum tattaqoon, taqwa. But some people say we fast in Ramadan, the reason is to feel how other people feel. No, this is hikmah and illah. So safar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put these rules into place, and the hikmah for it is what? Ease. So what is the illah? What is the reason we have this rukhsah in safar? What is the illah of rukhsah in safar? To shorten our prayers, wipe away our sores for 3 days, and break our fast in Ramadan. We're allowed not to fast in Ramadan. What's the illah? What's the reason? Because this is the hikmah now. But what is the reason? The illah of why we have this rukhsah in safar, huwa safar nafsu, the travel itself. That's the reason. And it's very important as we go on to know why this is the illah. That the illah for safar, or the rukhsah in safar, is the travel in itself. So therefore, it's very important for us to now define what is safar, what is travel, before we go on to the prayer of the musafir. Because the ulama, they say, حُكْمُ عَلَى شَيْءٍ فَرْعٌ مِنْ تَصَوُّرِهِ. Before we start giving rulings, because the ruling is only a small branch of something. The major branch is what? The definition of that thing. And anytime you study something in fiqh or in aqidah, you have to define things in two ways. Linguistically and according to what? The sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is a safar lughatan? A safar lughatan min as-sufur. وهو البروز والإظهار. The word safar, which you translate as travel or journey, is taken from the Arabic word sufur. And sufur is to become exposed. To become exposed or to give clarity, buruz, something we can't have clarity. And they say safar is called safar after this word of clarity and exposure. لأن السفر يسفر أخلاق الرجال. Because travel, it shows the true reality of a person's character. It exposes him and it gives clarity of his character. And this is why Umar radiallahu anhu, a person came to him, wa yuzakki fulan, and he's speaking about another person, such a person is a good person. So Umar asked him, asafartu ma'ak? Have you traveled with him? He said, la. Jawartahu? Have you lived with him or been a neighbor to him? He said, la. Ta'amalta ma'ahu bid-dinar or dirham? Have you done any financial transactions with him? He said, no. Idhan lam ta'arifu. In that case, you do not know him. You do not know him. Because when you travel with somebody, it shows the reality. And that's why the judges in the past, every time you give a testimony for somebody, a good reference, they will ask you these three questions. But in the time we're living in now, it is very difficult to know somebody's true journeys. Why? The journeys are usually very quick. So you cannot use this principle. It's very difficult to say, I know somebody because he's my neighbor. Because in the time we're living in now, you could be a neighbor to somebody, you don't know him very well. The world we're living in now. But the way you know people in the time we're living in is what? Financial transaction. So this is a safar lughatan. A safar, according to the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they say, a safar niyyah is the intention, mufaraqa baladul iqama, is the intention to depart from your place or your town of residency. This is a safar. And this definition, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, if you've got it in your head, all the confusions that will come up later on, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, it will solve it. So make sure you have these definitions. So we're going to look at ahkam of a safar. So the first thing the mu'allif, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned is that in regards to the musafir. He says, وَإِذَا كَانَتْ مَسَافَ سَفَرُهُ سِتَّ عَشْرَ فَرْسَخًا وَهِيَ تُسَاوِي مَا يَقْرُبْ مِنْ ثَمَانِينَ وَهِيَ تُسَاوِي مَسِيرَ يَوْمَيْنْ قَاصِدَيْنَ. He said, this is the first rule I'm going to look at, the ruling of what constitutes a journey. The author, rahimahullah ta'ala, mentions that if the distance of the journey, سِتَّ عَشَرْ فَرْسَخًا, is 16 farsakh. And a farsakh, one farsakh is equal to 3 miles. So 16 times 3, ya Salman. Quick math. Barakallah fi, mashallah. 48. 48 miles. And in kilometers, what is it going to be? That will be 48 times 1.6. Not so quick. Huh? About 90. The ulama, they say about 80. Because the exact thing is 76.8. So usually the ulama will say 80. 80 kilometers. 48 miles, 80 kilometers. And he said, وَهِيَ مَسِيرَ يَوْمَيْنْ قَاصِدَيْنْ. And it's usually of journey of 2 days. Why did they say 2 days? Based on the customs. Because of the Arabs in those days, what do they used to travel with? Camels. So they say, قَاصِدَيْنْ, journey of 2 days, عَلَى الْإِبْلِ مُحَمَّلَ بِالثِّقَالِ, upon a camel which is loaded. Because if the camel is not loaded, how would it move? Faster. But when it's loaded, it's moving at an average pace. And a camel in 1 day usually could cover 40 kilometers. And in 2 days, 80 kilometers. So the issue of the distance ties in with the issue of the time, according to the customs. So the Mu'allif, rahimahullah ta'ala, therefore, he's saying what constitutes as a journey is this distance. This is mawdi'u khilaf, a point of disagreement. The other scholars, they say no. They say no. There is no strict regulation in terms of distance and time what constitutes a journey. Kullu hadha yarji' ila al-'urf. It depends on the customs and the practices and the environment of those people. Jayid? So we're going to look at the evidence of each group of scholars, because this issue confuses many of people to know, am I a traveler, I'm not a traveler. So the first group of scholars that say it's 80 kilometers, what is the evidence? And this group of scholars, this is the jamhur, the majority of the scholars. And this is the madhab, Shafi'iyya, al-Hanabila, wal-Malikiyya. These three schools of thought, Maliki, Shafi'i, and Hanbali. As for Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala, is the opinion that this does not continue. No, Afwan, Abu Hanifa likewise, Afwan, the four school of thoughts actually. The four school of thoughts. The first evidence is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which he said, لا تحل لِإِمْرَأَةٍ تُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ أَن تُسَافِرْ مَسِيرَ يَوْمْ وَلَيْلَ إِلَّا وَمَعَهَا ذُو مَحْرَمٍ. It is not permissible for any woman who believes in Allah and the last day to undertake a journey of a complete night and a complete day, except where there is a what? Mahram. And a complete night and a complete day means 48 hours. Jayid? 48 hours. And how many kilometers, according to those customs, does a journey of 48 hours take? How many kilometers? 80 approximately. So the ulama, they say, although the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam don't specifically or explicitly mention 76.8 kilometers or 48 miles, it's as though he's saying this is what constitutes a journey. And this is what the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they understood. So Abdullah ibn Abbas and Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, they used to say, Ya ahla Makkah, la taqsuru as-salah fi aqall min arba'i burd. O people of Makkah, do not shorten your prayer as travelers in a distance which is less than 4 burd. 1 burd is equal to 4 farsakh. 1 burd is equal to how many? 4 farsakh. Or 1 barid is equal to 4 farsakh. So 4 burd will be how many farsakh? 16. 4 times 4, 16. Meaning again, 48 miles or roughly 80 kilometers. And this opinion of who? Abdullah ibn Abbas and Abdullah ibn Umar. And none of the Sahaba spoke against it. So he says, though it's ijma'u al-Sahaba, the consensus of the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu. The second group of scholars, they say no. And this second group of scholar is Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, contemporary Sheikh Ibn Baz, Sheikh Muhammad Ibrahim, and also Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah azza wa jal. They say no. And they base their evidence that there's nothing that could specifically constitute what's a journey, based on a journey. They say there's a principle in fiqh. For those of you taking notes, this principle is qa'idatul asma, the principle of names. And this qa'idatul asma is anna kulla ismin ulliqa bihi hukm shar'i. Every single name that's connected to a sharia, a legislative ruling, وَلَيْسَ لَهُ حَدْ فِي اللُّغَةِ وَلَا فِي الشَّرْعِ فَمَرْجِعِ الْعُرْفِ. If the language does not specify its amount or its quantity, every single name that's connected to a religious ruling, if the language itself does not give a specific measurement of that thing, nor does the sharia give a specific measurement of that thing, al-marji', the reference point is what? Al-urf, customs. So when it comes to safar, linguistically, is there a measurement of what safar is? How many miles? None. When we look at Nusus al-Shari'iyyah, the religious text, Quran and Sunnah, whenever safar is mentioned, is there a specific measurement given to it? No. For example, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when you're upon the face of the earth, this safar, إِذَا دَرَبْتُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جِنَاحٌ. You have no blame upon you for you to do what? تَقْصُرُوا, to shorten your prayers. To shorten your prayers. Now, in this ayah, does it specify the distance? Yeah. All the many ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا سَافَرَ, when the Prophet travels, he will shorten his prayer. Is there any measurement of, is there any measure of distance? No. So they say it goes back to the customs of the people. Now the first group of scholars said, fine, it does go back to customs. But when we look at customs of the people, the Sahaba, أَعْلَمُ النَّاسِ بِالْعُرْفِ, they're the most knowledgeable concerning customs. Like Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Umar. And what did they say? 80 kilometers. Secondly, if you're saying from a linguistic point of view, the Sahaba likewise, أَعْلَمُ النَّاسِ بِالْلُغَةِ, they're the most knowledgeable concerning the what? The lugha. And if they say 80 kilometers, it should be 80 kilometers. Jayid? And lastly, even if it was to surrender the argument to you that, okay, according to the customs of the people. Jayid? All of us in this room now, custom by custom, in order not to have ikhtilaf, custom is something which is agreed upon. If I was to ask you right now, how much on average is a kilo of tomatoes? You know, everyone knows, between 3 and 8 riyal or 4 and 8 riyal, depending on where you go. How much you pay for a certain car, you know the average thing when it comes to this. Well, how much does it cost to Sotho? By customs, Jayid? Now, we say, okay, by customs. All of us now in this masjid, if I travel from here to Masa'id, Jayid, according to customs and practice, can we say this is a journey or this is not a journey? Would you consider this to be a would you consider yourself to be a traveler? By customs. How many people say no? How many think it's a journey? Forget the distance, just the effort it takes you, the time. By customs, is it considered to be a journey? You can go and come back the same day. You don't consider it to be a journey. But some people, it's not far. But Qatar is a small country. A better example would be England. That is some place in England, you come out completely, you consider it to be far. And this is where the difference of opinion happens. That some people, to them, to go to Masa'id, even if you go and come back in one day, it's a journey to them. It's a journey for them. Or in big countries like Saudi Arabia, they consider it a journey. Where some people say it's not a journey. So this urf that you say we go back to is nothing that's agreed upon. There is no regulation. It's very difficult to regulate. So although there's no clear text specifying 80 kilometers, but we have aqwal al-sahaba, we have urf, which you're talking about, the customs. So if we go back to the customs, many people, anything less than 80 kilometers, they don't take it to be a what? Don't take it to be a journey. To be a journey. So even according to the urf of people nowadays, it's 80 kilometers. Now, because of the lack of dubt of regulation, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala came with another regulation to say, look, it goes back to customs. And he said that regulation is any journey which you take, you have to carry provisions and food with you. That's what constitutes, that's his regulation now. But this issue of carrying food or provisions with you, is it very regulated? No, even that. There are many journeys I could undertake now, which is 80 kilometers and even further, that I don't necessarily feel I have to carry provisions with me, especially in contemporary times. So even this is not regulated. So Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, the most authentic opinion to avoid ikhtilaf, difference of opinion and confusion is the aqwa, the statement of the jamhur, the majority of the scholars, which is 80 kilometers or 76.8 kilometers, 48 miles. Hada arjah. This is the strongest opinion to avoid ikhtilaf. Because once you open that door to people, some people travel 20 kilometers. To me, it's a journey. To another person, not a journey. So to avoid the ikhtilaf, and because aqwa the sahaba, this is the strongest opinion. Then he went on to say that mubahan lahu qasr afwan. That is usually a distance of 20 or 2 days. And it's permissible for him. Al-qasr. It is permissible for him to do al-qasr. Now al-qasr, he said, is mubah. Is permissible. Afwan. Rukhsatu al-qasr. The rukhsa of qasr, the mu'allif, the author mentions here, that the rukhsa, the permission of al-qasr, wa kana mubahan falahu qasr. If the travel is mubah, you could do qasr. What is al-mubah? Mubah are those actions which you're not rewarded or punished for. Therefore, if the travel is obligatory, safaru ta'a, a travel of obedience, you could also do qasr. Because if you could do it for something you're not punished or rewarded for, if it's an obedience, you definitely could do qasr. You have the rukhsa, the permission. So what the mu'allif, rahimahullah ta'ala, is trying to say is, if it's a safarun ma'asiyah, if it's a journey based upon the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have no permission for qasr, for shortening your prayer. For example, somebody travels to do a business trade in alcohol, for example, or goes to a foreign country because he wants to go to a nightclub and do indecent acts. The mu'allif, rahimahullah ta'ala, said there's no qasr. This is only in journey which is mubah or acts of ta'a. This is another point of contention, of disagreements amongst the scholars. The jamhur ulama, the majority of the scholars, the three schools of thought, except for Abu Hanifa, they're of the opinion that there's no qasr for a person who travels to do acts of disobedience. And the evidence is the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَمَنِ اضْطُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Whoever is forced to, without desiring, they say without desiring evil upon his journey, وَلَا بَاغٍ, or transgression in his journey, like to be a highway robber, Allah ta'ala is all forgiven. So therefore, he must not be desiring evil, and must not be doing his journey to transgress. They base the evidence on this ayah. Therefore, if he's traveled out of sin, he could not do qasr. The second group of scholars say, la. Why? They say, no. Based on the principle which you mentioned earlier on, what is the illah? What is the cause that makes you permissible to the rukhsa, the permission of shortening your prayers and safar? The journey itself. The safar itself. And we mentioned earlier on, the al-hukm, the ruling of something, is goes hand in hand with the what? The illah, the reason. So long as the reason is there, the hukm is there. Why did they answer the ayah there? They said this ayah is talking about the tafsir of it, the one that's forced to eat a dead animal or pork or blood out of necessity. Because how does the ayah begin? Inna maharra alaykum al-maytata wa-dama wa-lahma al-khinzir. Allah has made haram upon you the animal that's dead for you to eat, and the blood, and also al-khinzir, وَمَا أُهِلَّ بِهِ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ, and everything, anything that's sacrificed to other than Allah. So it's not with this. So this ayah, you cannot use it for this. So therefore, the most authentic opinion, Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, even if the safar is a safar al-ma'asiyah, a safar, a journey of disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the person could do take the rukhsa of a musafir, break his fast, shorten his prayer, microwave salt for 3 days. And then went on to mention, فَلَهُ قَصَرْ رُبَاعِيَّ خَاصَّةً. And he has qasr of ruba'iyya, those salat which are 4 units, which are dhuhr, asr, and isha. He could do qasr, shorten those prayers. As for maghrib and fajr, there's no qasr. And he said he has qasr of this salah illa, except if he's praying behind the imam was muqeem. For example, you walk into the masjid, it's salatul isha or dhuhr or asr, and the imam is a resident imam like this imam, but you're a traveler. Jayyid. The mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala is saying here, in such a situation, you have to pray the 4 units of prayer. You cannot shorten your prayer. You cannot shorten your prayer. And this, the mu'allif and the jamhur al-ulama, they base this on the action of the sahaba radiallahu anhum. That when the sahaba radiallahu anhum went for hajj, and the amir of hajj is the khalifa, is the leader of the Muslims in that time, and that was Uthman radiallahu anhu. And the khilafah Uthman lasted for 12 years. For 8 years in Mina, you pray qasr. For 8 years, Mina 2 rak'ah. For asr, dhuhr, and isha. The next 4 years, he prayed atamma, 4-4-4. And praying behind the wazoo, the sahaba and the musafirun. So the people went to Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhum. They say, مَا بَالُكُمْ, what is wrong? إِذَا صَلَّيْنَا مَعَكُمْ صَلَّيْنَا أَرْبَعًا. When we pray with you, meaning behind Uthman, we pray 4. وَإِذَا رَجَعْنَا إِلَى رِحَالِنَا, when we go back to our abodes, we pray 2. What is this? Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said to them, تِلْكَ سُنَّةُ أَبِي قَاسِمْ. This is the sunnah of Abu Qasim, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That if you're praying behind the imam, even if you're musafir, you have to pray what he prays. Tilka sunnah Abi Qasim. And this is sunnah wajibah. Sunnah which is obligatory. And where does this get this from, that this is sunnah Abu Qasim? The statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which he said, إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامِ لِيُتَمَّ بِهِ. The purpose of the imam is for you to do what? Do what he does and complete what he completes. So if you come to the masjid, you catch the last rak'ah. Jayid, because some brothers do this on purpose. They'll come and catch the last rak'ah. So the second rak'ah, he will pray the second rak'ah and do qasr and give salam. La. This is in opposition to the sunnah, according to his opinion. Why? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you come to the salah, whatever you meet, fasallu, wa ma fatakum, faqdu, or atimmu. And whatever you miss, make it up. So if you come and you look at one rak'ah, you pray it. But if you've missed the other 2 rak'ah, according to this hadith, what must you do? You must make it up. So what some people do, they come the last rak'ah, say, look, let's wait, let's wait, let's wait. And they catch the last rak'ah, they pray the second rak'ah, do qasr. La. You have to complete it, even if you're musafir. Because this opinion of Abdullah ibn Abbas, Uthman, for 4 years, he prayed atamma, completely. The Sahaba did not agree with it. In fact, when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was told that Uthman is doing this now, do you know what Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said? He said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. To him was a musibah. But yet when they'll pray behind him, they'll pray arba'an, even with their love of the sunnah. And Abdullah ibn Umar likewise, they pray with him and complete with him. The only exception, if you're praying behind the imam, you do not complete. There's only one exception according to the Hanabila, the Hanbalis, the Maliki, the Shafi'i, which is if you catch the imam after the last rukur. For example, the last tashahud. Because in that case, you've not caught the jama'ah. Because man adraka rukur, adraka raka'ah, or adraka jama'ah. So long as you catch the rukur of the salah, you've caught the jama'ah. But if he's in the last tashahud, you've not really caught the jama'ah. In that case, you could do qasr. In that case, you could do qasr. So these are the times where it's obligatory for the person to make up all the 4 units. And going back to the point of 80 kilometers, it's important to know that this 80 kilometers is not from your house. Some people start timing the speedometer from their house. It's not from your house. It's from the last residential area of your town. So long as you're still in the town, you don't start counting. When you start you come out of the residential area, the last building, it starts from there to the first residential area of your destination. And also the road sign. Sometimes you see 30 miles to Doha.
These road signs are not accurate in the sense that it's talking about to the middle of Doha, the city center of Doha, and not the outskirts of Doha. Jayyid? So these are the times obligatory to pay. Now, these are the times where it's obligatory for you to pray the four. Jayyid. Also, the Mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned other times where you cannot do qasr. And from these other times which he mentions is either you pray behind the imam or la yanwi al-qasr. He did not intend qasr. So for example, you're going to the masjid, and this happens many a times as a traveler. You do not intend to pray qasr and make takbir. According to Mu'allif, the author here, you cannot do qasr. But this is not correct. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to pray qasr al-sahaba, and he never told them once to intend qasr, to intend al-qasr. Nor did he ever show explicit say that niyyah is a condition. So the other ulama say, no, it's not a condition. It suffices for you to be a traveler, that's enough. In the same way that every time you pray now as a muqeen, as a person who stays here, as a resident, do you intend itmam to complete? You don't, because you're just a, what's it called? You're just a resident. You don't have to have the intention. And this confuses many people. That after the first rak'ah, I remember, subhanAllah, I'm actually doing qasr. Did I make niyyah? So what should I do? Do I do itmam or do I do qasr? La. So long as you're musafir, again the principle, al-illa, the reason is always connected to hukum. Just by qasr. Jayyid? So he says, unless he didn't make niyyah, or yansa salatul hadar, or if he forgets, he remembers a prayer which he forgot while he was resident. So for example, a person is traveling. And at the time of duhur, for example, remember, astaghfirullah, last night, before I traveled, while I was still a resident, I forgot to pray Isha. If he remembers that upon his journey, does he do qasr, does he pray two raka'ah for Isha, or does he pray four? He has to pray what? Four. Because the reason for qasr is travel. But at that time, he was a what? He was a resident. Or, he went on to mention, فَلْيَذْكُرُهَا فِي السَّفَرِ وَصَلَاتُ السَّفَرِ فَلْيَذْكُرُهَا فِي الْحَضَرِ. Or, for example, if he remembers a prayer he forgot while he was traveling, and now he's resident. For example, he remembers he forgot to pray Asr on his journey, which is only two raka'ah for him, Qasr. And then when he got to his place of residence, remember, astaghfirullah, I forgot Asr. Does he pray as two now or as four? He said he prays it as four. Because the other, the excuse of Qasr is gone, you're no longer a traveler. Another one that confuses many people, which doesn't really happen in Qatar, because it's a small town. If a person is missed Salah, he heard the Adhan of Dhuhr, and is upon the journey. And the time of Dhuhr is still in. And he's gone 30 kilometers outside his town. He's now past the last residential building. And he decides to pray Dhuhr. What does he pray as now? Because remember, the Adhan went off from when he was in his residence. Now he's upon the journey because he's 30 kilometers into the journey. What does he pray as? Because this Adhan went off while he was still in Hadar, Muqeem, while he's still a resident. But now he's outside by 30 kilometers. Does he pray now as four or does he pray as two? Four. Why? No, but he's on the journey. The 80 kilometers is what will constitute as a journey for him. But now he's on the journey. Musafir. He prays two. There's two opinions. One opinion is he prays four. Barakallahu fiqh. The second opinion, most authentic opinion, say la. He prays two. Why? Because the salah he's praying now is not qada, he's not making up the prayer. But rather, he's still within the time, if he's still within the time. So sometimes, like in England, the summer for example, time of dhuhr is long. So you could be 30 kilometers outside your residence, but the dhuhr is still in. If he prays it in his time, he's not praying it to make it up, he's praying it as the salah itself. And what is his hal at that moment? It's a traveler. So they say if it is still within the time, the most authentic opinion, he prays it as two raka'ah. But the opinion of the Mu'allif, rahimahullah ta'ala, he doesn't mention this here. He only mentions the issue of vice versa. And then went on to mention, وَلِلْمُسَافِرْ أَنْ يَتِمْ. That the musafir, he has the option to do itmam. Meaning the issue of qasr is sunnah mu'akkada, a very strong sunnah, but it's not wajib. And this is the most authentic opinion. Because if it was wajib, the sahaba radiallahu anhum, they will not pray behind Uthman. Two, while he prayed. Four, even though they believed, he should have prayed what? Two. Uthman himself, they believe he should pray two. So if it was a wajib, because the obligatory salah, they will not pray behind him. So, al-qasr fi safar sunnah mu'akkada. Very strong sunnah, which we should practice. Jayyid. And he said, wa afdal. And he went, and it's better. وَمَنْ نَوَى الْإِقَامَةِ. This is where most of the disagreements, they come in. مَنْ نَوَى الْإِقَامَةِ. That whoever intends iqama, to be a resident in a place for more than 21 salah, jayyid, he has his intention, فَلَا وَعِشْرِينَ صَلَىٰ أَتَمَّ. He must complete all his prayers normally. If you intend more than 21 units of prayer. And this particular thing, how long can you pray or take the rukhsa, the permission for? Concerning disagreement on this, there's 20, there's 20 different opinions on this alone. 20 different opinions. And this is one of the most famous opinions on it. That 21, how many? 21 salah, which is approximately how many days? Yes. About two or three days, you could say. It goes into, maybe into the third day. And that's why I find some people, after 3 days, they say no, no more. If you tell more than 3 days, khalas. Some other scholars, they say no, it's 4 days. And they say it's 4 days based on hadith, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Hajjatul Wida', the last hajj of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he stayed for 4 days in Makkah. And he arrived Arba'a Dhul Hijjah, the fourth of Dhul Hijjah. And on the 8th day, as the Hujjaj did, he went to where? Mina. So how many days? He stayed in Makkah 4 days. And he prayed Qasran. So this is clear proof. But this, so this clear proof, the ulama, they say, this action of Prophet ﷺ, حَصَلَ اتِّفَاقًا وَلَيْسَ قَصْدًا. He didn't do it on purpose, but it happened to just coincide. Meaning, if he had arrived first of Dhul Hijjah, he would have done the same thing. Because on the 8th day, you have to go to Mina anyway. So if he arrived on the 1st of the Hijjah, he prayed the rest of the 7 days in the same way, or the 6 days in the same manner. But because he arrived on the 4th, he had to leave on the 8th, he prayed 4 days. Do you understand? That if he arrived, let's say for example, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam arrived on the 2nd of the Hijjah, instead of the 4th of the Hijjah, how many days will he pray Qasr in Makkah? 6 days. Jayyid? So the issue of the 4 days is not explicitly said. It's just something that coincided. So therefore they say, no, it's not 4 days. Some of the ulama, they say 15 days. There's no narration for this. The only thing there's a narration for is 19 days. During Fath Makkah, Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhumah, he said during Fath Makkah, the conquest of Makkah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did qasr for 19 days. So he said, فَنَحْنُ, and we, if we intend to stay for more than 19 days at Mamna, we'll pray normally. Unless, and who is we? The Sahaba. And if it's 19 or less, we do Qasr. So there's 19 days, there's 4 days, 15 days. The other group of scholars, they say no. They say again, the issue goes back to what? The customs and practices of the people. What you consider to be what? A safar. What you consider to be iqama, afwan, to be a resident. But there's no strict regulation. To me, some people say, and this is why, because there is no regulation, Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah azza wa jal, is the people of this opinion, Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah azza wa jal, and also Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah again. Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah azza wa jal said, those working in Saudi Arabia, if they've not come with the intention of citizenship, which is almost impossible, or the intention of permanent residence, they could consider themselves as travelers. And everyone in Saudi Arabia, even if your great, great, great grandfather has been there, you're on iqama. There's no difference between a person that came yesterday and the person that's been there for 30 years. No difference, 40, 50 years. So those people, according to this fatwa, they'll be praying as musafir, they could pray for 20, 30 years. That's almost half of the population of Saudi Arabia. In Qatar, it would be 2/3. So imagine now, 2/3 of the population, we'll get an iqama every 2 years, 3 years. We're not on permanent residency. 2/3 in Ramadan, they're eating. 2/3 in Ramadan, they're joining their prayers and shortening their prayers. And that's why majority of the scholars do not take this opinion, that there's no time limit, or it depends on how you feel. But the scholars, they say that there's no time limit. They say, look, it goes back to urf. And they bring some regulations this time. They bring some kind of regulations. The first regulation which they bring is this. Very good regulations for a person. They say the first regulation is this. There's six regulations they bring all in whole. Do we have to stop now? We don't? Okay. The first regulation, I apologize for this long class, but it's very important because this is something that many people, they get confused on. The first regulation they bring is this. They say, the first thing is niyyah, the intention, iqama, mustaqirra, permanent intention, that I have intention to settle in this place forever. Yani mudda mustaqirra, for a permanent, yani intention to settle for mudda, a period of time which is considered to be settling. So therefore you say, for example, a person travels 150 kilometers and he comes back on the same day. Does he have niyya istiqrar to stay there? No niyya. The second regulation they put is صَلَحِيَ الْمَكَانِ لِلْإِقَامَ لِهَذَا السَّفَرِ. The expiry period concerning this journey for a person to say it could have residency there. And what is the expiry period? They say, for example, the Hujjaj. When you go for Hajj, you have a visa. That visa you have, does it qualify you as a resident or a person who's a traveler? A traveler. So say the Hujjaj, for example, there's an expiry period. So if they go to Makkah for 1 week, Medina for 2 weeks, they're just there temporarily. So it depending on how long the expired date is for your iqama or your travel ticket or your visa, you cannot consider yourself to be muqeem. You're not muqeem. You're musafir. This is the second regulation they put. The third regulation is nu'us sakan, the type of accommodation you're in. So for example, they said if a person descends in the haram, Makkah or Medina, for example, for some days, and even if his wife and his children, the whole family with him, so long as he doesn't own a house, he doesn't rent a house, and he's not bought furnishing, he's a musafir. Because normally you have to have your own house, but he doesn't. He's in a hotel or in a tent, for example. So those people, for example, that take this fatwa and say, you know what, there's no urf, there's no regulation. You have people in England, they've been on a mortgage for 25 years, and a musafir, I'm a musafir. I have no intention to settle in England, I want to go back to Africa. You have people here, they have no intention, I'm only here for 1 year, gonna make my money and go back. They've been there for 10 years. So based on his intention, I'm not settled, I'm a musafir. La. So long as you have a house, you bought furniture, you stocked up your house with IKEA, you know what, I'm still a traveler. Who does that as a traveler? So they say, no, a second, the type of accommodation. Fourthly, they say, the reason, the hajj, the need in itself. If the need is tied to time, if the need is tied to a fixed time, a long fixed time. For example, some people need to go abroad to study, jayid, and they know the course will take 6 months, for example. They know that. Or they're going for a particular course for 3 months. These types of needs that is tied or connected to a long period of time, or people that work in the embassies, for example. Some people work in embassies abroad, Saudi embassy, Omani embassy, and for all those years they're paying qasr. He said, no. If you have an intention to do something in a place and it's tied to a fixed time, you cannot pray as a musafir. You have to complete your salah. And the fifth regulation that they put there is mata' al-athath wal-athath. Again, issue of furnishing and where you live. For example, if you're not normally a person that lives in tents, all you have with you is a tent, you're living in a tent, for example, in a particular place. Based on this athath, this furnishing, you consider yourself to be a traveler. And the last regulation is the benefit of you being there. What are you going to this place to do? So you get people, they're border guards, for example, or they guard certain islands or land borders, and they have temporary structures or huts, and they live there for years with their family. And they border guard. They could not be considered to be permanent resident because of the intention of going to that place. Jayid? So these are the regulations that they've put in place. But the most, Wallahu ta'ala a'adam, opinion, the strongest one I see, the issue of the 4 days is not really strictly explained there, is the statement of Abbas radiallahu anhuma. I find it to be the safest, which is 19 days. As for saying it goes back to Urf, even this is not strictly, although they're trying to put some regulations here, it will more apply to what we're going to mention next, which the Mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala mentions. And what the Mu'allif rahimahullah ta'ala mentioned, which is almost the same as what those people are saying, there's no regulation of mentioning, is he ended by saying, وَإِن لَمْ يُجْمَعْ عَلَى ذَلِهَ قَصْرًا أَبَدًا. And if he has, if his cases, for example, is not made an intention, it meaning he doesn't know when he's going to go. He doesn't have no idea when he's going to go, meaning he's gone to a place, he's got, and his iqama, or is staying in that place, is tied to a need. And he has no idea when that need is going to be fulfilled. It could be tomorrow. For example, someone goes for medical treatment, and they say, look, the operation is next week, the week after, 2 months' time. So long as that's his situation, he could pray qasr forever. Like Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, he went to Azerbaijan, he prayed qasr, he took all the rukhsa for the musafir for 6 months. Because between him and his road or his path was a snowfall, he couldn't leave. He wanted to leave. So if you're in a situation whereby you have no idea, I'm going tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, you pray qasr. But if you're in a situation, for example, I travel to Nigeria, for example, I'm not a resident of Nigeria, but I've made intention, I'm going to be here for 1 month, and I've intended that, I could not say I'm going to pray qasr. Even if I'm going from one auntie's house to one uncle's house to one cousin's house, la. Because one of the conditions, even according to people that say goes back to custom, is what the type of living arrangements. You could not do qasr over a month. Another question which comes up is people that travel this distance daily, bus drivers, pilots, they're going up and down every day between Makkah and, let's say, Medina. Can they do qasr? If you're doing it every day? Yes. Because the reason is what? The safar in itself. Even if there's no hardship. Because the hardship is the hikmah and not the reason. Because you get people traveling, so it's like, taqillah ya akhi, between Makkah and Medina, 1 hour only on a plane, akhi, where's the hardship? Even if there's no hardship, the reason the rukhsa is connected to the what? The safar and not the mashaqqah, the hardship. So I expect there'll be some questions there, inshaAllah ta'ala. I don't know if we have to leave. If there's any questions, please free to ask now, inshaAllah. Let me give about 5 minutes or something for questions, inshaAllah. Any questions? No.